the main thing that we need to be. A few years ago, in a different lifetime it seems, when I had some money, I used to go every year at this time to the Ritz-Carlton on Amelia Island in Florida, and I'll tell you a little more about that later. But it's not because I had the money to go, it was because that was a brand new hotel and they were offering all of these promotional rates. And I got to know the people down there, and they would give me some discounts, and I would save all year long for it, because this is the time of year that my husband died. And I like to take those days, you know, a few days, just to be by myself and think and reflect on all the things that I'm going to be doing during the year. And I've turned it from an oh, woe is me kind of thing to planning and looking and organizing for the year and trying to feel what God is calling me to do for that time. And if you got to do something like that in a place, the Ritz-Carlton is a really cool place. I can't afford it anymore, but long time ago I did. And I was up on the, what they call the club level floor, because actually if you pay a little more, you get food all day long. And it's cheaper than if you go to one of the restaurants and pay your mortgage payment for a cheeseburger, okay? So it's actually cheaper to do that. Well, I was up there one day, and the what they call the club was crowded. You know, they, even though it was January, they had a lot of people there, and people were coming in and out and getting food. And somehow this one man who wanted to check in to the Ritz down at the front desk was told there wasn't room for him on the club level. And he was evidently someone who did a lot of traveling, and he wrote about traveling in places that he had been to. And he was just not going to accept the fact that they did not have room for him. There was no room in the inn for this man. And he decided he was just going to go upstairs to the club himself, and if he had to knock on every door, he was going to find a room for himself. And he had his wife with him, and they came upstairs, and as soon as he entered the room, everybody turned because he made his presence known. He was a big guy, he was full of himself and full of a lot of other stuff too, and he wanted to have a room. And it didn't matter who had to know about it or who he had to get rid of, he was going to have a room. And he was talking to the ladies that were up there in the club itself, mostly, you know, responsible for putting food and beverages out and things like that. And he was just being totally obnoxious. I want a room. I am a traveler. I write about traveling. I can trash your hotel if I have to. I deserve a room, and you will find me a room. Well, I just don't like that. He was getting on my nerves. And he was really messing with my down retreat time. And I don't like people that are that arrogant anyway. You will find me a room, and I am supposed to be here. And then he looked at his wife. He said, you know what, honey? I know there's some people up here that don't belong here. And I thought, well, no, he's talking about me. I got no problem with that. But I went over to him, and I said, sir, you're looking for a room? And he started talking, and I said, that must be really frustrating to want a room. You can't get one. He goes, yes, and they obviously don't know who I am. And I said, well, who are you? And he said, well, I'm so-and-so. He told me some name. And he goes, I'm a travel writer, and I could really do damage to the reputation of this hotel. And I said, well, that's a shame, because I love this hotel. It's a great thing. And I said, you said that obviously there were people here that didn't belong. He goes, absolutely, because he looked around the room at all the different people. I said, so I would imagine that the people that belong here are those that have a lot of money in the bank, probably have a lot of money in several banks. Yes, probably businessmen or politicians or people, you know, with a lot of prestige in their life and things like that. He goes, absolutely. I said, probably nobody from the farm or a little town or anything like that. He goes, of course not. And I said, probably, you know, not anybody that has to struggle and scratch all year long and save just for a couple of days in paradise. Well, certainly not. This is just second nature to me. And I said, it is. Well, I don't have any of those things that we just mentioned. I don't have a big bank account in several banks. And I don't have a job as a politician or a big businessman or anything like that. And he said, you don't? And I said, no, but you know what I do have? He said, what? I said, a room. Somebody that was so obnoxious and bombastic and just bellowing that he was more superior, that he was better than the rest of us, and he belonged there, and the rest of us did not. We all belong everywhere, in the best of places, in the worst of places, because we are God's people. We are God's ladies, we are heirs, and we are supposed, if we want, as he said, to experience his glory, we must also experience his pain. And you don't usually think, like Karen said, of the princess doing the regal way, you know, doing anything that would cause them to get dirty, or have any issues or problems, or get dirt under their fingernails, or be working in a garden and pick up a dirt clod, you know, and if they do anything wrong, it will be covered up and certainly never be on the news, you know, and they wear all the right things. How many of you have seen all the different pictures of what Duchess Catherine wears all the time? And they made, in one magazine, a statement one day that she had worn that dress before. I got clothes that are 30 years old. I've worn them before, and I'm quite proud of that. I'm getting my money's worth. I cannot believe what the world gets centered in on sometimes. We all are entitled to the best of things, and when the worst of things happen to us, when we say, why me, why me, why me, sometimes we need to say, why not me? Because that's just the way it is. That's just the way things are. And there is a bumper sticker that says this pretty much. It's just two words. And the last word is happens. Some things just happen. Jesus had a way of saying this. In John 16:33, and please write this verse down and go and learn it, memorize it, put it in your heart and your mind, because it will help you when you are doing that why me thing. Jesus is talking to his disciples shortly before his death, because he knows when he dies, they're going to have all of these human questions of, he's not who we thought he was. We thought he was the Messiah, but look at him, he's dead, and what is this? We just don't understand. So he's telling them this three things in this passage. The first thing he says is, I'm going to tell you something so that in me, Jesus, you can have peace. Just say, peace. And let your shoulders come down. Take a deep breath. Stress will kill you. He says, I'm going to tell you something so that in me you can have peace. This is Jesus speaking. In this world, you will have trouble. I love that he said that. And if anybody had trouble, he did. In this world, you will have trouble. Everybody. Has anybody not had it? We're going to take you in the parking lot and beat you on the road. So you will have it today. In this world, you will have trouble, but he doesn't leave us there. The next part says, but. It's like those commercials. But wait! There's more, you know. He says, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And if he can overcome the world, so can we. And more importantly, he said, it means I am going to open a portal into eternity so that whatever you're facing now compared to eternity is really nothing. Yeah, it's bad. things happen. And Jesus says, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And you know what you are? When you follow in his footsteps and you gain entry into eternity, you are an heiress. You are his heiress. Because he is opening and building a place for you right now. And when the time is right, he says, I will come again and take you to be with me for eternity. I've been an heiress. I didn't even know it. I've been an heiress. I've worked in the church all my life. I have a master's in Christian education and worked doing Sunday school and children's ministry and Wednesday night programming and all the educational things behind the scene. Yes, behind the scene. I never expected to be in front of anybody. Behind the scenes was where I wanted to be, me and this, okay? Because I just didn't feel like I was the person that needed to be up front. So I did all of these things behind the scene and worked in the church all my life. And met a lot of different kinds of people working in the church. You always meet a lot of different kinds of people working in the church. And I know that there were people that thought, wow, working in the church, you must walk around in gowns, you know, and robes going like this all the time, and it must be so sweet and wonderful. Not. Because the church is made up of all of us, just like everything else. But I got to know this couple, Kenneth and Louise McLean. And they were an older couple because I was visiting with the older adults in the congregation. And when you walked into their home, it was like you walked into another time zone. Just a whole bubble of that was away from life. She collected dolls. He raised orchids. Everything was frills and lace, and it was just like you were in a different world altogether. And they would sit, and they just loved having company. But not that many people came to visit them because they were older, and they tended to want to talk about everything. And I knew that when I went to visit them, I better set aside about 3 hours, and then it would be hard to get away still after that. But I love those two. They had each been married before. They met each other on a singles cruise when they were both in their 70s. There's hope, you know. They got married and none of their kids liked it. They found love again, but their kids didn't like it. So their kids didn't come to visit that often. So they kind of adopted me into the family. And I adopted them because when I got married, I asked if they would come and sit as my honorary grandparents, because all my grandparents had died except one, Bertha. Oh. She was just a mean old woman. There are mean old women in this world, or there wouldn't be problems with mean old women in this world, okay? And Bertha was there, but I wanted somebody that I felt really a connection to. So I asked Kenneth and Louise to come and sit as my grandparents. You wouldn't have thought that I had given them the keys to the kingdom, that I had given them anything that I had, that they were my heirs. They were so proud and pleased to do that. Mr. McLean made me an orchid corsage that was about the size of a football for my going away corsage. It covered half my body. And I already had one, but I put that aside and I wore his corsage because he wanted to do that so desperately. And they sat as my grandparents, and we just had this relationship back and forth. And they loved Jerry, my husband. And they both died, and I didn't think anything more about it. He died first and left money to take care of any of her needs as that they would come up. And the children got mad about that too, that he was leaving money behind to take care of his wife. His children wanted his money. Well, he loved his wife, and he took care of her, which is, I think, what a noble thing to do. After Mrs. McLean died, the money was supposed to be divided up as he instructed. There was a will, and he was very specific about this. I knew that she died and went and was in the that we had. Until about 3 years after she died, I got a phone call one day. And this woman said, "Hello, I'm so-and-so from the firm of yada, 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 you know, a law firm." And I was like, "Oh, gosh." You know, you feel guilty and you haven't done anything. It's like, "Oh, no, what have I done?" And you start wondering, I don't need a law firm calling me. Who's suing me? Oh, my gosh. You automatically think something's been done. And they said, "We're trying to locate Cathy Lee Phillips." And I said, "Yeah." And they said, "Are you Cathy Lee Phillips?" And I said, "One of them." "There may be others. Do you know a Mr. Kenneth McLean?" I said, "I knew a Mr. Kenneth McLean. He has died." And they said, "Yes, we're aware of that." And they said, "Did you know his wife?" And I said, "Yes, Louise, she has died also." "Well, we need to make sure you're who you say you are." "Well, how do I prove that?" And they went on, this lady went on, and she said, Were you married to a man named Jerry Phillips?" I said, "Yes." "Was he a minister?" "Yes." "Is he deceased?" "Yes." "Who are you and why are you asking me these questions?" "Well, because you have been named in a will." And I was like, "A what? Are you kidding me? What do you mean? What are you talking about?" And they said, "Yes, Mr. McLean died 4 years ago. And he named you in his will. You're an heiress." And I said, "I am. Well, I've never been one of those before. Except when my husband died and, you know, left everything to me. I couldn't believe it." And my first thought was not, "What a kid." That was my second thought. But my first thought was, "He loved me enough to remember me in his will? Are you kidding?" And they said, "We have to know who you are. We need some proof. Do you have anything with your former address where you and your husband lived together so we can prove that you are who you are, a tax return or, you know, an old bill or something like that? And can you write down a few of the memories that you have of Mr. and Mrs. McLean?" And I told them about the wedding. And I was in the hospital one time at 28 having my tonsils removed, which is the most painful thing I had endured. And Mr. McLean rode the bus, because he couldn't see well enough to drive, rode the bus to bring me an orchid flower arrangement. It was huge. And people from all over the hospital, doctors and visitors and nurses, were all stopping by to see this incredible orchid bouquet. And so I wrote down these things that only, you know, could have happened to somebody that knew them. And they said, "Okay, well, you need to send us something or fax it or whatever." So I did that, and the next morning, FedEx stopped and delivered a package to me, and it was a check for $10,000. And the attorneys apologized that it was not more, but because of the children, the will had been tied up in probate for 3 years. So there were a lot of legal fees and things like that that had taken money away from the amount that he had. I was perfectly fine with $10,000. I was amazed with $10,000. In fact, I was sitting the day that they called and trying to figure out how I could afford to put a down payment on a new vehicle that I desperately needed. Well, that prayer was answered. And that vehicle was bought with that $10,000 that came as a result of knowing Mr. and Mrs. McLean. I'd never been an heiress before. And I didn't feel like I needed a crown or anything like that. What I felt was totally, completely unworthy. Did I do enough for this? I mean, I don't know what he left, if it was a percentage or a certain amount or whatever, to be $10,000. It had to be more before, you know, to start out with that. I was amazed that somebody loved me that much, that they would have remembered me in a will. And it just lets me know that we need to be careful, because we don't know the impact that we make in certain lives sometimes. And that can be positive or negative. And I put a $10,000 price tag on my relationship with these two people. I remember them as the grandparents that I chose for my wedding. And I remember orchids, and I remember dolls, and just being with them and having a great time. $10,000? Wow, I'll take it. I never expected it, but what a great spiritual surprise. What an incredible answer to prayer that after 3 years, on the day when I was sitting and trying to figure out how to make a down payment, suddenly the next day, I was given a check for an incredible amount of money. To me it is. Probably to the guy at the Ritz would have been nothing. But to me, it was huge. If you really ever want to get irritated, watch a few minutes of Toddlers and T.O.s. Have you seen it? I want to smack them all. The kids, the mothers especially, who take infants who don't even know what's going on, and they dress them up and all of this stuff, and they walk them across the stage like this, showing them off. Let my child be the prettiest, because it's most important to be pretty, you know. And the kids going, what are we doing, you know? And then as they're getting a little older, you know, they walk across the stage in whatever cute outfit the mother has, and a lot of times she's out in the audience showing them what to do. And the mother is making a bigger scene with the kid on the podium. And the kid's looking at her like, what am I supposed to do? Okay, I'll turn around. Okay, I'll throw a kiss. And one mother, I was watching one night, told her 6-year-old daughter, now turn around and shake your booty to the audience. And her 6-year-old daughter said, why would you tell me to do that? I was like, go, girl. Why would you tell me to do that? If a parent loves you truly and respects you for being a true child and a human being, that parent is not going to tell you to turn around and shake yourself to an audience or parade you around just so you can get a crown saying that you're the prettiest. It's not what it's all about. And I'm not saying this because I'm not the prettiest. I'm saying this because it's not what it's all about. Do you know Miss America's coming on tonight? I thought, Karen, what incredible planning. She didn't know. I told her a while ago, Miss America is coming on tonight. When I get a crown, I want to have earned it by the things that my hands and my heart and my mind do. I want to earn it because I am in contact with the King of creation who allows me to touch somebody's life so that I can get $10,000. No, I was more humbled than anything when I got that amount of money. More humbled than anything you could have imagined. I want to be used by Christ, not paraded around the stage. I want Christ to use every bit of me, every bit of energy I have, every bit of intelligence I have. I want to be able to stand before Him and say, I used it all. I used it all. You gave me words to write and words to speak. You gave me positions to be in and contacts to make, and I did it all. I even used this, okay? Because we need to laugh, and we need to joke, and we need to see what our priorities are, and it's not shaking our booties at the audience or being the prettiest. It's using everything, getting down and dirty like you're digging in a garden of sin and ugliness and trying to bring some growth and beauty to that garden. Every once in a while, there's going to be somebody that comes and gets in your way and causes you pain. And you can take it for a while. And then sometimes you might say, I've had enough. Because sometimes it's good to say no to evil. I've had enough. You will not do this to me anymore. And And I struggle with when it's time to do that and when it's time to keep turning cheeks, because I don't know how many cheeks I'm supposed to have. I struggle with that because I'm Christian. I am not perfect. But when I stand before God, He will look at me and He will be amazed at the things that were done in spite of my humanity. In spite of